1990. It was an ending and a beginning. For 21 years on crisp fall Saturdays in the historic town of Ann Arbor, legions of true blue football fans had basked in the glory of the Wolverine, while a man named Shem Beckler held court on the sideline. They came to see him call the plays, to roam the sidelines, to storm the field, a referee in his sights. And every once in a while, you could count on those pulse-pumping dramatics. Who in the crowd didn't feel it when Bo would fling his headset to the turf and invite the striped shirts to discuss the situation? That was always a treat. Critics and fans alike followed his every move, questioned his calls, got mad, got over it, and came back for more. He was their mythic warlord, leading his winged helmet warriors into battle, and more often than not, emerging victorious. This was the big show, and Saturday afternoon was passionate. But now it was changing. Even though the place would be the same, even though the 105,000 plus fans would stand and thrust their arms in salute as the marching band played the greatest fight song ever written, even with all that, on that sacred sideline, it would be different. A new man would be calling the plays, and that would change, some people said, everything. His name? Gary Moeller. Mo to those who knew him best. And now this Lima, Ohio native, this captain of Woody Hayes' 1962 Buckeye squad, this longtime assistant coach under Shem Beckler, was stepping into the old man's shoes. You couldn't help but hear the talk. The word legend was most prominent. How do you replace a legend? How do you replace someone who over two decades has won 80% of his games, 80%. And to go along with that, there had been 13 outright or shared championships. How do you follow that performance? How do you take the place of a folk hero whose position in Wolverine football history is forever lighted by the glimmering starlight of maize and blue greatness? And if replacing a legend wasn't enough challenge for Moeller, there was more. Before Bo stepped down, he had put another notch in his legendary belt. Back-to-back undisputed Big Ten championships. First time the Big Ten had seen that in 23 years. No conference team had ever won three outright championships in a row. So everybody waited and wondered, waited for the season to start, and wondered what Moeller might be able to pull off.
When you hook me once in a while like this. He
did have a lot going for him. The fans, players, and coaches knew him and knew him well. Except for a side trip down to Champaign, Illinois for a short stint as the Illini's head coach, he'd been a Michigan man since 1969. And after all, he was Bo's choice, hand-picked to lead the maize and blue. What's more, everyone was used to seeing him on the sideline. Maybe that would help. But with the exception of a stand-in role for Shem Beckler during the Hall of Fame Bowl in 1988, which Michigan won, no one had seen him as the head coach. Interestingly, he would become only the ninth Michigan head coach of the century. That kind of longevity speaks volumes about Michigan football and the men who become its head coaches. Another point in his favor was the 1990 Michigan team. The other Big Ten coaches had picked Michigan to repeat as conference champions. But with all these things, there was still that challenge, the transition from Bo to Mo. Wolverine fans had three dreams, a third straight outright Big Ten championship. No Big Ten coach had ever done it. A national championship, something the legend never got. And a better record in bowl games, another blemish in the former head coach's celebrated career. So in early January, as Gary Moeller took his place in the big chair in Ann Arbor, the fans wondered if this new guy could deliver their dreams. Undoubtedly, Moeller wondered too. 1990, an ending. the closing of the Schembechler years, and a beginning, the dawn of a new era that, in the proud tradition of maize and blue history, will surely be marked as Mo's first season.
Wants to go deep and does on the post. Howard breaking open. He's got a touchdown, Michigan. Angles to his left, got a big seam. 20, 25, he's on his way. 30, got blockers in front for the 50. 45, cuts back to his right. He's going all the way. Here's the snap, placed down by Solem. Carlson's kick from 37 is up, and it is good. Michigan has beaten Ohio State.
Bo had called me in his office, told me of his plans and things, and my immediate reaction was, Bo, just let me do some more of the work. You can still wear the hat, and I'll do more of the work and things. And I always remember him saying to me that, Mo, if I'm going to coach, I'm going to do it the right way. And you know I have to coach and coach hard, and this is the best thing for me, and I want you to be the coach.
The one thing that I'm really proud of, too, is the fact that how many football coaches who come to the stage in their career as mine, when it's time to leave, has an opportunity to name his successor. That was very important to me because I wanted a man here who thinks like I do, believes in the Michigan system, who has great integrity, great character, man who's got a great knowledge of the game of football, a tough guy. He was a great competitor as a player. I think he's going to be a great coach here as well. And so I'm naming Gary Moeller as my successor. He'll take over the job January 2nd.
A lot of people had anticipated that I was told a long time ago that I would be the head coach. Bo had never made that statement to me. He always said jokingly, yeah, you wait till you're the head coach. Let's see what you're going to do. Or you're going to put up with all this media and I can just go do something else or whatever. You just wait till then. But yet he always said that jokingly. And I, in some ways, got the idea, hey, you know, this is going to be great if this happens. But I didn't sit around and just necessarily wait for this job knowing that I was going to get it because I thought Bo would go on a few more years.
I haven't talked to this man. All I talked to this man about was replacing me. I didn't say what I'd pay him. I didn't say what length of contract he'd have. I didn't say, did I say, did we cover any of that?
10 years, $200,000.
Okay, whatever
you
want.
I covered it, no.
Whatever you want.
No.
Here, you go ahead. I'm going to go over here.
Thank you, Bo. Thank you very much. Obviously, it's a very, very happy day in my life, and to become the coach at Michigan is really something special. And I know it's hard when you're going to follow Bo Schembechler, and I expect that, and everybody associated with the program, and all of you know that that's going to be a tough act to follow, but we're up to the work, I believe.
On January 2nd, 1990, Gary Moeller joins an elite club whose members include Yost, Chrysler, Oosterbahn, and Schembechler. Though his first battle on the field with Notre Dame lies 9 months away, for Moeller, the war begins immediately, the recruiting war. The high school wonders of today will become the college stars of tomorrow. Attracting the best and brightest to Michigan is crucial to the football program, and especially in his first season as head coach, crucial to Moeller's position of leadership. The question is simple. Without Schembechler, will top players still choose Michigan?
Oh, I think they definitely looked at me differently because they didn't know exactly who is this Gary Moeller. Like when Bo walked in, Bo's presence alone would recruit a young man. I think I had to take a different approach. I think I had to, I don't want to say sell harder because I don't like to necessarily use the word selling in anything. I just want to explain what Michigan is all about. But I had to approach that in a little different way. And I didn't have that presence, so to speak. But yet I felt very comfortable in doing it and stole some ideas from Bo and yet employed some of my own.
In early February, the experts give Moeller the Big Ten championship in recruiting. Notre Dame, the Fighting Irish, South Bend, Touchdown Jesus, and for 6 years now, Michigan's opening game. But this is more than an opener. It's Moeller's opener, his head coach coming out party. The media is already calling it the battle for the national championship. Wolverine fans are calling for revenge. The Irish have defeated Michigan 3 years straight. Not too many teams have done that. Even fewer have downed the maize and blue 4 in a row. And as the media points out, only one Michigan head coach has ever lost his opening game. If the phrase weight of the world on your shoulders ever described anyone, it described Gary Moeller. And as game time approaches, Gary Moeller mulls over what he really wants in this, his historic opening contest.
You want to make sure your kids play hard, you know, and when you play Notre Dame in South Bend, you know they're going to play hard, or you think they are. You just don't want them to become intimidated. I think we had enough seniors where that didn't happen to us. And that's, again, why I wanted to say, hey, let's get after them. Let's be aggressive offensively and not sit back and just wait for a mistake and try to capitalize on it. I wanted to create something.
As the game begins, Michigan does create something, a scoring opportunity for Notre Dame. It happens in the opening drive on the second play from scrimmage, when Wolverine tailback John Vaughn fumbles. Nobody even hits him, but the ball pops out. The Irish thank Michigan with 7 points. Moeller surprises the crowd and the Irish too with a no-huddle offense. It keeps Notre Dame guessing. And the young maize and blue tailback, who'd coughed up the ball on the opening drive, recovers and recovers well. Charging out of the backfield, he powers Michigan downfield. The drive ends with a three-pointer. And it's anybody's guess now about how this one may turn out. The Irish storm back, score again, and as the first quarter ends, it's Notre Dame 14, Michigan 3. But Michigan will own the second and third quarters of this one. In the second quarter, it's Elvis Gerback to Desmond Howard for a 44-yard touchdown strike. A play so pretty that many Wolverine fans are already forgetting about Michael Taylor and Greg McMurtry. However, Notre Dame leads 14-10. But in the third quarter, Michigan goes on top. It's 85 yards and 11 plays. And even touchdown Jesus doesn't seem to be able to help Notre Dame. Michigan 17, Notre Dame 14. Notre Dame tries to come back, but runs smack into the middle of a fired-up Wolverine defense. Michigan takes the turnover and lightning strikes.
Here's a quick toss in the left flat. It's caught by Howard. He puts a move on. Smith down the sideline. 10-5. It is a touchdown. No, they're going to say Desmond Howard stepped out of bounds, or are they? It is a touchdown. He stayed in.
Michigan 24, Notre Dame 14. It is a joyful moment, a brief celebration in which it appears that something new has been born, something powerful, unstoppable. Finally, after 3 years, Michigan is kicking the Irish and kicking them hard. People have always marveled at what they call the luck of the Irish, and maybe that's what it is, as a third down pass intended for Rocket Ismail bounces off his hands and into the arms of a surprised Lake Dawson, who takes the ball all the way to the Michigan 41. It's a 41-yard gain, and 9 plays later, Notre Dame scores to narrow Michigan's lead to 3 points. But now, that 3-point lead may expand to 10 for Michigan. Vaughn leads the attack. Could there be any doubt that Michigan is going all the way on this drive? Then it happens. Notre Dame intercepts. There's 10 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. For 5 minutes, the two teams battle indecisively. With less than 5 minutes remaining, Notre Dame takes possession and marches 76 yards in 9 plays to take the lead. Notre Dame 28, Michigan 24. The Wolverines need a touchdown to take it. they have a little more than 90 seconds. On their first play, Gerback, who'd made that show-stopping pass to Desmond Howard earlier in the game, tries for a replay. But Notre Dame gets the ball and the victory. John Vaughn has slashed the Irish for 201 yards rushing. But Notre Dame has the only statistic that counts, the win. Vaughn says, we didn't lose the game. Time just ran out.
And maybe the worst thing that happened in that game, as I look back on it today, that I didn't feel at the time, everybody was kind of praising us, so to speak, in a loss. And, you know, I think sometimes that's one of the worst things that can happen. You think you played better than you did. You want to say, hey, we did well at times. But the bottom line is, did you win or did you lose? And I think it really hurt. And yet sometimes I think, well, maybe if we'd have got beat 24-0 in South Bend, it would have really got our attention a little bit more. But I don't know, I had mixed feelings about it because I was happy the way a number of individuals played. And you had to go back to the drawing board and try to figure out what you were going to do the next week. But disappointed and yet happy in some ways.
In college football, the tides of fortune cannot be predicted. What is to happen over the next 3 weeks of the season will propel Michigan into a position they haven't occupied in 13 years. It begins at Michigan Stadium against UCLA. The year before, these two teams had battled to a last-second Michigan victory. In 1990, things will be different. While the Wolverine defense throttles the pass-happy Bruins, the big names on offense this day are Gerback, Vaughn, and Alexander. Michigan leaps to a 21-0 lead.
Person left tackle fouling forward, and is he in or is he not in? No signal yet. Jefferson very close, touchdown Michigan. Sitting at right half, Vaughn at left, they're flowing right. Vaughn cuts it upfield, dives over the tackle by Collier into the end zone. Touchdown Michigan. Right out of the eye, Jefferson off right tackle, finds a little seam, it's a fake to him. What a fake, Gerback going deep to Alexander, instead he's got it. Inside the 30, down to the UCLA 27, one of the best fakes I have seen. High formation, hand off to Vaughn, going left, gets a block from Bunch, turn in the corner at the 20, the 15, the 10, the 5, touchdown, John Vaughn, a great...
There's never any doubt about this one. Vaughn ends the day with 288 yards rushing and three touchdowns. The final score is a maize and blue backers' delight. Michigan 38, UCLA 15. And for Gary Moeller, it's a milestone. His first victory as head coach. Moeller comments to reporters, "It feels as if something has been lifted off my shoulder." In the locker room, the players mark the occasion.
We as a team would like to present the game ball, Coach Moeller.
For an old rookie coach like some of you guys, that's a good one. Thanks a lot. Hey, I appreciate that, baby. I do.
7 days later, against Maryland, the scene is set early. Wolverine defense. The defense forces six turnovers this Saturday afternoon and holds the Terrapins to just 17 points. On offense, Michigan racks up 45. It ends. Michigan 45, Maryland 17. The opening loss to Notre Dame seems further and further away. Now it is time to open the Big Ten schedule. And that refocuses the mission, a third straight Big Ten championship. At Camp Randall Stadium, the Wisconsin Badgers spend October 6, 1990, chasing Michigan all over the field and rarely catching them.
Gerback straight to throw. standing in there, firing down the middle. It's caught by Howard, crossing route, down to the five, breaks the tackle by Troy Benson and goes into the end zone for a Michigan touchdown.
Michigan in the wishbone formation, handoff, John Vaughn, right tackle, fighting forward, touchdown! John Vaughn was hit at the one, but leans forward. Handoff, Ricky Powers going right, looking for his first collegiate touchdown, turns the corner at the five and goes in! Ricky Powers!
For the Badgers, Michigan's defense is stifling, allowing just 189 yards, the fewest yards allowed by a Wolverine team in 5 years. Michigan leaves Madison with a dominant 41-3 drubbing of the Badgers and a 3-1 season record. The talk around the college sports world now cranks up a notch. The Wolverines may be the best team in the land. But talk is cheap, especially when you're the head coach and you've added everything up.
I knew at the time that our team wasn't that good. I know potentially maybe we could get there with a few breaks and maybe some luck or whatever, but yet we're awfully young. And now, you know, you lose a Steve Everett in the Maryland game after the game before you lost John Milligan, our linebacker. So the injuries started creeping up on us, and I think took a little toll. Excuses I don't plan to offer to anyone. I think that's poor in sport. You have to pick up the pieces and go to work, and someone else has to play in those positions, and other people have to assist by playing harder. But yet, it did take away from the direction we were going.
Though Moeller is concerned about the team's inexperience and injuries, it doesn't stop the experts. Their votes propel Michigan to the number one ranking in the country. First time Michigan has been there since 1977. And now, as if decreed by fate, Gary Moeller finds himself in a position to deliver what Michigan fans have been dreaming about. A third straight Big Ten crown and the national championship. Some say it's easy. All he has to do is win. The first team that stands in his way, hoping to turn dreams into nightmares, is the Wolverines' next-door neighbor, Michigan State.
The one game that you want to win more than any is the Michigan State game because of the in-state rivalry. The Ohio State game is very important. Now you know the importance of the Notre Dame game as well, but you want to beat Michigan State.
If this matchup is traditionally the battle for bragging rights, the tradition over the past few years has taken on a new luster. 4 years straight, the winner of the Michigan-Michigan State game has gone on to win the Big Ten championship and play in the Rose Bowl. So this 1990 contest can be viewed as a battle for it all. Michigan's number one ranking is on the line. Their quest for a third straight undisputed Big Ten championship is up for contention. And well, those bragging rights, they're something you never want to lose. Michigan starts out looking like the number one team. And again, it's Vaughn racing downfield. Then Gerback looks for Derek Alexander.
White wing go! 28 or Yost. White wing go, 28 or Yost.
The only wideout is Derek Alexander to the right. And Gerback pumps once to throw, now lofts it up in the corner of the end zone. Alexander has it. Touchdown. What a catch. A down.
Michigan 7, Michigan State nothing. State comes right down.
Second and goal from the 8. And Enos is going to throw. Now he's going to run. Takes off up the middle. Down to the 2. Dives over a tackler into the end zone. Touchdown, Michigan State. Dan Enos.
Now, you know what we talked about? You know what we talked about? We talked about the enthusiasm of this group right here after they score. And we got to get it going. Got it? We got to get it going.
The Wolverines take the ball and move to the Spartan 3-yard line. It's first down and goal to go. But in 4 tries, the Wolverines can't punch it in. On their first drive in the third quarter, the Wolverines take command, march downfield, and this time, Jared Bunch powers across the goal line. Michigan 14, Michigan State 7.
That's the way, Bunch. You hang on that ball. You got to hang on that ball. That's the way to run.
But as before, State answers quickly. They move 80 yards in 15 plays and tie it up at 14-all as the third quarter comes to an end.
Was a number one ranking getting to us? I didn't think so. I still don't really know today that I can say that that was the whole reason.
In the history books, what happened on October 13th, 1990 in the fourth quarter between the Michigan Wolverines and the Michigan State Spartans will be marked as one of the most exciting 15 minutes of football ever played. And if your Saturday afternoon colors are maize and blue, one of the most controversial. On their second possession of the fourth quarter, the Spartans move 69 yards to go on top.
Enos gives the ball to Hicks, a little cutback move. He breaks it through the middle to the 15, breaks a tackle at the 10, the 5, touchdown. Highland Hickson goes 26 yards, breaking two tackles on the way, and the Spartans have taken the lead for the first time this afternoon.
It is the first time since 1980 that Michigan State has put more than 20 points on the board against the Wolverines.
But I didn't think our defense now was playing like it should play. And now you start to wonder.
With under 6 minutes to play, the maize and blue mood is more blue than maize. But the Wolverines still have a little magic on their side.
John Langlo to kick it off. Dangerous Desmond Howard and Derek Alexander are back deep in the twin safety spots. Here's Langlo's kick, high, a little short. Howard will grab it at the 6 and head up the middle. Angles to his left, got a big seam, 20, 25, he's on his way, 30. Got blockers in front to the 50, 45, cuts back to his right, he's going all the way. Desmond Howard has scored 94 yards on the kickoff return. No flags, Michigan answers with 5:50.
All tied again, 21-21, just 5:50 on the clock. The Spartans don't need that much time. A little more than 3 minutes is all it takes.
Enos gives it to Duckett, finds a hole left side, he's in, touchdown, Tico Duckett.
Michigan State 28, Michigan 21. And now it looks like the number one ranking, the undisputed third straight Big Ten title, and the bragging rights are leaving Ann Arbor like a rocket. But the 106,188 fans in Michigan Stadium and the millions of TV viewers across the country are about to see something they will never forget. And all with less than 2 minutes to play.
It's fourth down and 6 from the Michigan 33. Alexander slot right, Howard wide. Ball on the left hash. Gerbach sets the throw. Back around the 23. He's got all kinds of time. Rifles it. It's caught by Howard at the 44. It's a first down.
Michigan middle. 693 middle.
59 seconds left. Third and 3. Gerbach to throw. Looking down the middle. Now fires. And it's caught by Debo at the tight end at the 42. That's a first down. It'll stop it. Back to throw. He's got Vaughn in the left flat. Hits him at the 28, and John steps out of bounds for the first down with 22 seconds to go in the ball.
And as we went down the field, you start gaining confidence, and then you create a lot of positive excitement, which, was a great feeling.
Clock running, 10 seconds left. Gerbach lofting it up for Alexander. He caught it down! Derek Alexander, who dropped 3 passes earlier, adjusted to the football. Alan Heller, the corner over Ranum, and with 6 seconds left, Michigan is down 28-27, and now the entire stadium is chanting 2 for the 2-point conversion.
Gary Moeller, in his first Michigan-Michigan State matchup as head coach, has a decision to make.
Yeah, I wanted to go for 2. Anytime you ask kids in that emotional setting that what their response is going to be, they aren't going to say, hey, let's tie the game. I wanted to beat Michigan State. That was important. The other thing was in the back of my mind, and one of the reasons that decision came about was the fact that if we win the Big Ten championship outright again, It's never been done in the history of the league. And so you keep going back to that and you say, we got to win them all. And we can't take this opportunity away from the kids to win the game.
Here we go. This is the ball game, folks. Two-point conversion attempt. Gerbach to throw. Lofting it up in the end zone.
Desmond Howard has it. He's got it. He beat Eddie Browder, did he? What do they call him? He dropped the ball. Oh, my goodness. Desmond Howard could not hold it. Unbelievable. What are they going to call now?
I thought there might have been interference.
Even though Desmond Howard is tripped, the referees make no call. It seems that the only people in the stadium who didn't see the penalty are the men in striped shirts.
Hey, he tackled the guy in the end zone.
They tackled him. What the hell did you watch? What?
Did you look at the receiver?
Let's go. Let's go.
Hey. You can't choke like that. It's your job to identify. You got to look at it. Your job is to watch the play. You didn't see him grab him. What were you looking at? You just lost us the game. I want you to know that. I want you to know it, and I hope you bear that the rest of your life, son, because you screwed us big time. Big time. Did you watch the players, or weren't you watch the ball? You got to be kidding me. You guys are unbelievable. That is unbelievable.
I think I'm happy that we went for it. I'm very disappointed in the fact that, let's say it honestly, that we got it taken away from us a little bit in the way that we did.
You got to be kidding. The big play and they choke. Just flat choke.
Sometimes officials just don't want to do anything in those circumstances. Just let the kids play and let the outcome happen. And really, we're neglectful in this circumstance.
The score goes into the books as Michigan State 28, Michigan 27.
The guy tackles Desmond. You don't get a call, but that's part of living. Now, what we got to do is stay focused on where we're going and what we want to accomplish as far as the Big Ten race, and we can still do that. Now, you know, all that has to happen is we got to win the rest of them. Michigan State's got to get beat some way, which that could very well happen. But we got work cut out for us. There's a lot of guys with great effort out there. I think today we didn't score the one time we got down there. We missed a chip shot field goal. We can't do that. And then our defense, I know you're banged up. And there's injuries. And, you know, you always got to have a guy ready to go. And we didn't have, I don't think, a couple people ready to go. And that hurt us because no one ever has taken the ball, particularly that team. That team went across our goal line 4 times today. That's as many as they've crossed our goal line in the previous 7 years. So we got to work our way back. We got a lot of things to do. But we aren't dead yet. There's going to be some guys that probably play pretty damn well. We're going to keep ourselves together. We're going to give us direction. We're going to know where we're going to go. Now we're going to find out who we can count on, right? But we got to be ready to go to work. I don't want to hang our heads. Don't want to do anything like that. But we got to play a lot better football than what we played today. And as I said, we're going to find some guys played pretty good. That's it.
The next day, Big Ten officials admit that on the 2-point conversion, the referees had blown the call.
Well, it was tough because no one would let us lose the game. Everyone knew we lost the game, but no one would let us lose it because they kept wanting to talk about the 2-point play. And now as I look back on it, Jim, again, as I mentioned it after the Notre Dame game, maybe it would have been better if we got beat worse than what we got beat. Only from this standpoint. Again, people are telling us that we're a better team than Michigan State and we were robbed, so to speak, in their terminology. And again, they start patting you on the back for being pretty good, and yet you got 2 losses.
Hayden Fry and the Iowa Hawkeyes enter Michigan Stadium on a homecoming Saturday with thoughts of upset in their minds. It is a sunny, mild day in Ann Arbor. Temperatures hover around the 60-degree mark. Memories of what had happened in the corner of the northern end zone just 7 days before hover in the minds of just about everyone. As the first quarter winds down, John Vaughn scores, and Michigan leads 7-0. Iowa fights back in the second quarter and passes downfield. The Wolverine defense can't seem to stop the air attack. Michigan 7, Iowa 7. The offense takes the field and the lead, driving 55 yards in 8 plays to put Michigan back on top 14-7. In the third quarter, Iowa kicks for 3. Michigan 14, Iowa 10. Michigan can't get the first down and punts it away. Iowa takes possession. Their series ends in a punt. The Wolverines block the kick, and Dwayne Ware picks it up, scampers for 7 yards, and Michigan leads 20-10. Now the fans can't believe what they see. Michigan fakes the point after kick and goes for 2 points. But Jared Bunch gets pulled down. A collective why reverberates throughout the stands.
I want to win this championship outright. I don't want 2 losses. If I get an opportunity to go for 2 any time in a game, I am going for 2. I was informed that the play that I wanted to run was there the time before, okay? And what we did, we had an automatic on, and really the guy calling the automatic wasn't on the same page that I was on. That play shouldn't have been called. And again, that's not the young man's fault. That's my fault. Because if I'd have coached it properly, we wouldn't have tried that play, because at this time now, it wasn't there. It was taking away from us, and we shouldn't have attempted it. And it turned out to be a big play in this game. But again, I wanted to get out of the tie situation because I didn't want to end up with a tie, a loss to Michigan State in a tie. So early in the game, I was going to try to break that tie relationship scoring-wise.
Nobody knows it at the time. But this 2-point play, like the 2-point play a week before, will become the difference between victory and defeat for Gary Moeller and the Michigan Wolverines. In the fourth quarter, Iowa, not about to give up, drives 67 yards to score and cuts the Michigan lead to 3. Michigan kicks a 47-yarder and makes it 23-17, a 6-point lead and 4 minutes and 27 seconds to play. But Iowa quarterback Matt Rogers completes 7 out of 8 passes to lead the Hawkeyes to Michigan's doorstep. Then Kujava barrels in. The extra point is good. And with just 1:09 left on the clock, the fans are stunned to see the scoreboard. Iowa 24, Michigan 23. Michigan still has time. But Iowa intercepts Gerback's pass, and it's all over. Iowa 24, Michigan 23.
We're not folding our tent. We're going to come back, play the game the way it's supposed to be played. A hard, physical game, and stay together. You don't look at anybody else. We all got to look at ourselves, gentlemen. That's what we got left for. But our offense didn't back up what we should have done there today. We had some colossal screw-ups, and we should have never been put in that position. Okay? That's it.
It is the Wolverines' second loss in the Big Ten. Their second 1-point loss in as many weeks. And not since 1967, as the mighty Maize and Blue dropped back-to-back home games. Some said the wheels have come off, that the Wolverines are about to enter a long, dark season of frustration and defeat. And so it starts. The criticism, the second guessing, the whispers about what the old coach would have done. For Gary Moeller and his young squad of Wolverines, it is time to take a deep look inside, a gut check, to see what you're really made of.
You're playing good football, quote unquote, but you're losing. And, you know, there's something wrong here. There's something that we're not doing right. And so we kind of went back to the drawing board. And now, on Monday, when I left the office and went out into the general public, so to speak, to a press conference, and you get comments from people and you get feelings when you communicate with people, and I knew right then the most important thing is to get the door closed. Keep the people away from the players and get our focus back to what we wanted to accomplish. Now the question was this, were the players going to buy that? Because see, your players could say, well, you know, what's this guy doing, and look to blame someone else, because it's so easy that all of us look for excuses in life, and we don't want to very often go look in the mirror. You know, I want to say, well, what are the players doing? The players want to say, well, what are the coaches doing? And this is the attitude of a lot of people and a lot of programs. And this is when I truly understood, Jim, what's going to happen in the next few months, really, is the character of the individual and why this was a great, great senior class. Not a good one, because this team had a chance to fall apart. This team could have taken another direction in life, and they could have questioned Gary Moeller and what was going on. But my captains and my seniors didn't listen. And I told them we had to focus on where we're going. Forget the outside world. You're going to hear all this crazy comments, but we are Michigan, and we are important, and we can be good. Sure, we've been banged up, but we know there aren't any excuses. But we can be good. We just got to make sure that we do it now.
Close the door. Character. The outside world doesn't understand these things. They want victory or blood. They don't come out and say it. But when you're the target, you know.
The people were talking about how well we played losing to Michigan State and Notre Dame, that now it's the Iowa. They realize, hey, it's 3-3, that, hey, we aren't doing so well. And maybe we did mess this thing up. And so, oh, we get a lot, you get a lot of letters, you know, and you get articles in the newspaper. But I always get a lot of letters, no matter whether you win big or lose big, and you get love letters. Some of them are good, some of them are bad. But yet I had a lot of people that were very supportive, too. But, you know, you can get 10 great letters and you pass it off. You get a negative one or a comment going down the street or leaving the barbershop of, oh, these one-point losses are terrible. And it's not so much what they say, it's how they say it and your feelings about it. And it was hard. And sometimes you really find your true friends. And sometimes, as we all can imagine, when you sit in that big chair, so to speak, you sit there alone on many, many occasions.
Now Moeller looks ahead to a pivotal game against the Indiana Hoosiers. Pivotal because it is a test for him and for the Wolverine. He tells his squad that it's time to start again.
And we're going to start all over again. As cheap as it may sound, we're going to try to erase some of those memories, and we're going to Bloomington, and we're going to start all over. And we're going to play with great emotion, and we are going down there, and we're going to play tough, physical football. And the one thing we're going to do, we're going to spend more time on blocking and tackling. We're going to tackle, we're going to tackle, we're going to tackle, we're going to tackle. I knew we were going into a hornet's nest. I knew, didn't know for sure how our kids were going to respond. I thought we did all the right things, but you just never knew. And now you're going into a place where the team had beaten you a couple years ago down there. They had confidence, their coaches had confidence. They had tied an Ohio State team, which they probably should have beaten. They had a great opportunity to beat. So I knew this was a good team. And yet I think we got that focus back. And you know what we did? We got mad. We got mad at this. I got mad a little bit from the standpoint that I know we aren't doing as much as we can, or we can get more out of this team than this. And our players played mad, I think, so to speak. Because, you know, I don't know if we were mad at Indiana. I don't think we were so much mad at ourselves. I think we were just mad at the outside world that, hey, we're by ourselves in this one. We're Michigan. We have a few fans out there that are really supporting us, and believe me, you always have some great fans, Jim. There's some super ones out there. But, you know, we're going to go this one alone. We're out there on an away trip. We're away from people, and we're going to play hard, hard, smash-mouth football.
Smash is the word to describe this one. The Wolverines smash through the Hoosier defense all afternoon. The defense puts their hands around Indiana's throat and doesn't let go. Michigan walks away with a 45-19 victory.
I wish somebody just holler, just maybe even a nasty word out loud or something.
Ah! Yeah!
Hey, one thing, look.
Back on track.
Hey, yeah, we're back on track, all right, but look. And as far as I'm concerned, we're starting a whole new season today in Bloomington.
The team is coming together.
It's surprising, and people don't always understand us, how close a team can become sometimes when you go on the road. Because you have, well, you have a little support, as I said, those some of those true fans go with you. But you're in enemy territory, and if you don't come together as a unit, you can forget it. And I think the timing was right, and that really helped us. And a lot of people look back and they said, oh, Indiana, Purdue, you were supposed to beat them anyways. Yeah, I understand we were supposed to beat them. But yet, it was a true test for us.
The test of Michigan's second season, as some call it, continued. Another away game, Purdue. Michigan aces the test. Even with the offensive fireworks, it's the Michigan defense that writes today's story. They force five turnovers and hold Purdue to just 62 yards rushing. The final score, Michigan 38, Purdue 13. At the beginning of the season, many thought that Michigan versus Illinois would be the game that decided the 1990 Big Ten title. With a 3-2 conference record, however, Michigan's title chances are slim. But there are things on the line today. If the Wolverines entertain any hopes of attending a New Year's Day bowl game, they must win today and for the rest of the season.
We were going to keep our focus, and the main thing is that we wanted to pound Illinois.
Michigan pounds Illinois. The bad news is, while racking up 214 yards in total offense, Michigan has just 9 points. Three Carlson field goals, including a 51-yarder. So it's 9-3 as the teams head for the tunnel. In the third quarter, Carlson kicks again to put Michigan ahead 12-3.
The thing I was most frustrated about in that game was the fact that we were moving the ball up and down the field, kicking field goals, ended up with, what, five? And that was a frustrating point because you're sitting there thinking in the last drive, hey, this game should have been over in the middle of the third quarter.
It continues. Michigan's defense dominates the Illini. Now Michigan takes the ball, runs three plays, and sets up for a punt. But Eric Anderson has something else on his mind.
It's a fake. The snap goes to Eric Anderson. He's sweeping the right. First down, 45-50, and Eric Anderson.
And now a freshman tailback named Ricky Powers looks downfield and sees the end zone. He carries five times for 41 yards, and it ends with a celebration.
Matt Elliott snaps it back to Gerback. He hands to Powers up the middle. Hurdles a man and goes in. Touchdown,
Michigan 19, Illinois 3. But Illinois comes to life. It's 30 yards for the touchdown, and Michigan's lead has been cut to 9. Michigan answers with another Carlson field goal to make it Michigan 22, Illinois 10. On their next possession, Illinois jumps right back into the game with a trick play. Illinois has surprised the Wolverines and the fans. Two TDs in two possessions, and suddenly Illinois is just 4 points down, with an agonizing 10.5 minutes on the clock. Michigan doesn't move, and the Illini have it right back. They go to work. The Maize and Blue faithful are questioning their faith. They've seen back-to-back Illinois touchdowns, and now it looks like the go-ahead TD drive is unfolding on the carpet below. But Michigan's defense has something to say about that.
Here's the flea flicker. Lester gives it back to Wax. He's going deep. Throws it to Beta Murray. Intercepted at the Michigan 2. And Murray goes out of bounds.
Once again, the defense has made the difference. With 6 minutes to play and the ball sitting on the Michigan 2, Moeller gives his young men their mission.
We got to get this ball out of here. Number one, we can't punt from inside our 10-yard line. That was the key, is to get the ball moved out a little bit and keep our defense off the field.
With the guts and determination of champions, Michigan gets the job done. Nothing fancy here, just grind it out on the ground football. It's 12 plays and 4 first downs to victory.
After that game and that drive, you know, I thought, hey, we're back in the swing of things.
A week passes as Michigan basks in the glow of victory. But now against Minnesota at the half, the Wolverines trail 10-7. The Let's Start All Over second season is about to run aground. But in the final 30 minutes, Michigan wakes up.
And Gerback straight back to throw. Blitz coming, swings it out left side. Bunch down to the 5, puts a shoulder down in. Touchdown, Michigan! Gerback looks to throw, lofting it up. Left corner end zone. Alexander, touchdown, Michigan!
At the end, it looks like there had never been any doubt. Michigan closes out the home season with a 38-15 win and holds on to the little brown jug.
Now, next week, you are going to go into one of the greatest games you've ever played. It's one of the great spectacles of sport. Don't let anybody crap you. I don't care what the scores are, what the records are, what anything is. It's one thing. You're playing Ohio State, guys.
We want to beat Ohio State, and we're only going to do it one way, and that is to be the most physical team that day in Columbus.
That's why every guy takes care of himself tonight. And we got 7 days, guys, 7 days, and we're going to play our butts off when we get to Columbus. There's no more beautiful place to go to. You know why? Because I'm going to tell you this. It's 64 guys down there that just come and gather together and know the whole world's against them.
This can be a great year. Okay, not like we wanted to, but it still can be a great year. And all those things we talked about and believe in, the character of a team coming through in a second season, kicking out the adversity and all those things that happened ahead of us, this can still be a great year. But you got to win in Columbus. You got to win in Columbus.
Beating Ohio State. It's winning the big one. It's bringing a team back from the brink of disaster, and in many ways, it's letting the ghost of the old coach finally fade away. The game is a throwback to the old days, a classic battle of maize and blue and scarlet and gray. The Buckeyes take a 10-6 lead into the locker room at the half. In the second half, Ohio State adds 3 more to make it 13-6. Still close, but Michigan fans know they've been close before this season, and close is not good enough. Derek Alexander gets things started.
Williams kick along the ground again, bounces once, twice inside the 20, picked up by Alexander on the 17. He heads upfield, he's got a seam, 30, 35, pulls away from Foster Pope, up the sideline, hit from behind as he crossed midfield, carrying tacklers with him, all the way down to the Buckeye 37-yard line. A 46-yard kickoff return.
But 3 plays later, it's 3rd and 13. Ricky Powers gets the call.
They run the ball. Powers breaks outside to the right to the 35, 30, gets down to the 28, and the Buckeyes gang tackle him a yard short of a first down.
Moeller goes for it.
And they run the ball off left tackle. Powers has the first down. He's inside the 25.
Three special. 6 plays later, Elvis Gerback lines up the offense and puts Desmond Howard's name on the ball.
Howard's foot to the left. He's got double coverage now. Unless Beal comes on a blitz, which he might do, he's up on the line. He is coming. Man coverage to Howard. Gerback finds him on a slant. He beats Hulk and goes in. Touchdown, Michigan.
Michigan 13, Ohio State 13. For the next 22 minutes, it's Wolverine versus Buckeye. Hand-to-hand combat in the trenches. Defense. It's Cooper versus Moeller. But it looks like Woody versus Bo. But this day, it's Gary Moeller calling the plays, roaming the sidelines, and yes, storming the field to discuss matters with the striped shirts. It's pulse-pumping dramatics, and it's a treat.
Hey, listen, you ask him. That's a simultaneous. Come here! Boy.
Now, late in the fourth quarter, Ohio State, deep in their own territory, faces a nerve-wracking decision. It's fourth and inches. Do they play for the tie or the victory? Ohio State decides. They're going for it. Moeller calls his battle-hardened Wolverines to the side and tells them what they must do.
The main thing is that you wanted to make sure that the kids went back out there with, hey, you are going to stop this team. Technique and play it aggressively.
They line up. The fans come to their feet.
Line up two tight ends, high formation on fourth down. They run the option. Fry is going to be hemmed in. He's not going to make it. The Wolverines gang tackle him on the 29-yard line.
Now, with less than 2 minutes to play, Michigan takes over and positions for a field goal. How much more can be riding on a single kick? This is the game, the season, the proof.
Listen to me. This is the biggest extra point you guys have ever had.
Michigan 16, Ohio State 13, Wolverine victory.
Listen to me. We're very proud, gentlemen, where we're going New Year's Day. And if you can cheer loud and we get those Gophers going, we'll go.
I thought, hey, this made the season a success. There's no question about that. And it was tons and tons of weight off your shoulder until you start thinking about now you're going to win a bowl game. But there's no question about that. But the more importantly, Jim, you know you brought the kids back from something, or they brought themselves back from something, and now you got their confidence back, and you can build on this. And they know one thing. When you win at the end of the season, no matter what's happened before, you go out a winner.
A few hours after the Wolverine victory over Ohio State, Minnesota defeats Iowa, and Michigan grabs a piece of the Big Ten title. It's a four-way tie, but to Gary Moeller, it still means one thing.
The thing that we can say is we still are the champions of the Big Ten because we have had this title three consecutive years. Now, the last year, obviously, we're sharing it with someone, but we still are the team. And, you know, anytime you're a champion and the kids have been a champion three straight years, it really means something. But it wasn't the way I pictured it or I dreamed about it this summer when I visualized winning the Big Ten Conference.
The victory in Columbus also sends the Wolverines to a New Year's Day game, the Gator Bowl, where they face the highly touted Mississippi Rebels. It becomes a numbers game. Michigan gets all the good ones. In the first half, Michigan explodes for 273 yards. 169 belong to Elvis Gerback. He's 12 for 18 with two touchdowns. The Wolverine defense frustrates the Rebels, yielding 47 yards rushing and just 73 through the air. Michigan leads 14-3 at the half. In the second half, the Wolverines are even more dominant.
Gerback drops into the hole to throw, has time, fires left side, he's got Howard. Howard makes a nice spin to the inside, 40, 35, 30, he's gone! It's magic again, Desmond Howard, 50 yards for his second touchdown. Gerback off a fake, going back to throw, Alexander wide open on the post, has it for a touchdown, he beat Tyrone Ashley.
When it ends, Michigan has piled up 715 yards in total offense. Almost 400 rushing. Gerback has four touchdown passes, and well, it's a blowout. Michigan 35, Mississippi 3. The bowl victory gives Michigan a 9-3 record on the year.
I think 9-3 sounds good to me, but not to the teams that we lost to. I don't want to lose to them. I am happy the way the season ended up, believe me. And maybe I learned as much as I told you about those players should learn from this kind of season and things to do in the future. But remember, those cards come up different every time, every year, every game. And so you had to make those adjustments. But there are some things I know that I will remember. And attempt to correct, if that's the right term, if the situations occur like they did. But yeah, I was really pleased at the end of the year. I don't think we could have ended up obviously any better, but I can't get those losses out of my mind, and I don't think you ever can.
As Gary Moeller finishes his rookie year as head coach, with all the memories, with all the reflections of what could have happened or should have happened, one thought is uppermost in his mind.
Your first team as a head coach, Jim, particularly your senior class, is very, very important to you. Those kids play for you 1 year. They had to adopt you, and you had to adopt them. We had some trying times, and I can honestly say that this is a group of guys that I'll always remember, because, as I told them, they could have folded their tents. You could go a different direction, but you didn't. And this is really what life is all about, because you're going to have greater adversity in your lifetime than you had at the beginning of the season at Michigan. But this will help prepare you in something that I hope you will never, ever, ever forget. And yet you are champions. And really, the way we ended up, in my opinion, we were the best team in the conference.
There was no doubt now, not in anyone's mind, Bo was gone, Mo was here. And as for the dreams of Michigan fans, well, they had dreamed of another Big Ten championship. Moeller had brought that to Ann Arbor. Maybe not outright, but over the winter, you could still say Michigan was the conference champion. And they had dreamed of a better record in bowl games. Some folks pointed out that counting that Hall of Fame victory when he was the acting head coach, Mo was undefeated in bowl games. And as for that dream about a national championship, well, somehow when you reflected on this 1990 season, when you looked at what this Moeller guy had done, how he had led the Wolverines out of the darkness, well, somehow you felt that maybe this was the man, the one who would, on some January 1st, sometime soon, lead his winged helmet warriors into battle, and when it was all over, for all the maize and blue faithful, it would be a dream come true.